Brothers and sisters, fathers and mothers in our midst. All right? Mr. Eric, would you pray?
Good morning.
Good morning.
How's everyone doing today?
Good.
Good, a good rest?
Thank you.
You know, I want to thank your church leadership again. It's such a privilege to be here. And Pastor Ron is, and Pastor Jasmine is one of the people that God has divinely connected us with the last couple of years, and we consider them, you know, spiritual fathers and mothers. And Esther and I have been very privileged, you know, to be under, you know, their care. A lot of times when they come, we'll spend time talking and be asking Pastor Ron for feedback, for advice. You know that he has a he carries the heart of a spiritual father. Amen.
Amen.
So when he was hijacked by your boy, you know, that's because of the call of God, the passion, and he understood what God was calling him to do, to serve, you know, in whatever capacity he could this season to help this church go through, because that's the heart of the father. And I like what you said about the son of the house, the daughter of the house, because ultimately it's about calling and vision. And the ones that understands calling and vision most in the house is those who have lived in the house.
Yes.
Amen. Now, it's not that it's impossible for someone outside to come. Of course it's possible.
Yes.
Just that it's a bit more challenging. And then if you can have someone in the house, of course that makes sense. Right? And we have seen tremendous. Our church is actually a very lay-driven church, and I attribute that to our former senior pastor, Joyce Williams, that she understood that if the church had to be strong, it has to be lay-driven. Okay? Led by pastors, driven by lay people. Led by pastors, driven by lay people, or led by pastors, board members, led by your leaders, but driven by lay people. Meaning that at the end of the day, it's the lay folks that will drive the church. Because how much work can, I don't know, 2, 3, 4, 5 pastors do?
Yeah.
Right? In terms of limitation, right? How many hospital visitations can a pastor do? Right? It has to be driven by the laity. Alright, and we understand the fivefold ministry that God has given the prophet, teacher, apostles, you know, all that. And it's in Ephesians teacher is clearly for the equipping of the saints. Alright, it's clearly for the equipping of the saints. So the real ministry work per se is to be driven by the laity. Alright? By the way, I hate this word laity at full time. You know, because it doesn't make sense. All of us are full time. All right. In fact, people ask me, are you full time? I said, no, I'm overtime. I'm overtime. You know, come, let's pray. Father, we thank you for this church. We thank you for your grace in this church. We just pray that as we continue to look upon you and your word, that you speak to us, that you lead us, that you would reveal your heart to us, that cause us to see you for who you are, and what you can do in and through our lives, and what you desire for us. Always the best. That we will learn to surrender, to give our lives to you, so that your call, your destiny, your purpose in our lives can be fulfilled. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. Praise God. Now, if the PA folks can help me just to lower down my volume a little bit, can you help me just to bring it down? Praise God, thank you. Is that okay? Now, church camp is for such a time as this, just lower down a little bit so I can. That's the praise God. Okay, that's good. Alright. So I can speak a bit louder, alright? Good. Now, such a time as this, and you know, this is a wonderful team. You know, I love to preach about calling and destiny because of my own journey with the Lord, how the Lord has led me, and I see that at every point, ever since I was young, I knew God, how God was leading me, how God was guiding me, my family. You know, when I was about 6 or 7, I think, less than that, maybe 5 or 6, when my parents were deciding to buy a house, because we were staying in a different area altogether. We were staying in a place called, ironically, Jalan Ipoh, alright, in KL, okay? So Jalan Ipoh in KL, and we were staying there. My parents wanted to buy a house, you know, this is the 19, 76, 78 maybe, alright? And so this is what I was told, of course, they told me, right? And so, and there was this developer, alright, who built, they had two locations where they were building. One was in Kepong, one was in Tamantun. Now, how many know where Kepong is? In the KL Kepong, or Kepong? No? Alright, that one is Tamantun, Tamantun of this Mayang. Alright, and so this developer built two different housing areas, exactly the same house. If you go to Tamantun and Kepong, you'll see exactly the same housing shape, exactly, right? Just two locations at the same time. And so my parents were deciding where should we buy. That time, Tamantun is like not developed, you know, and Kepong also not developed, you know. So they were saying where to buy, and then finally they chose Kepong. Wrong choice. Because the houses in Tamantun is like literally almost, you know, double the houses in Kepong right now. We talk about investment, say, bad investment. But if I would have not landed in Kepong, I would not be where I am today. Because it was in Kepong when we shifted there. Then I went to school, Standard 1, and then we connected with a guy called John Chiang, just a random friend who was in school. Parents got to know, and then he says, oh, my son goes to church, want to go or not? And I'm like, okay, go. That's how I ended in Bethany. 9 years old. And I've been there 30 over years. The divine coincidences of God that will bring us and lead us to where we need to be and should be and where we ought to be in the future. Amen? And so it's about really alignment. There needs to be an alignment, congruence, where when we begin to live our lives, we don't live aimlessly. And so yesterday in Colossians, Paul was praying, he says that I pray that you will know the complete will of God for your life. And so every time we lead our lives, there is absolute clarity in what we're doing. The jobs we are in, the people that we should be marrying, of course, one only, huh? Who you should marry, the jobs or vocation, what you should study. One time I was asking one of my youth, I said, she finished SPA, I said, so what are you going to study? They said, accounting. I said, why accounting? Because my mommy told me, I'm an accountant, make a lot of money. You know, and I was sharing with her, it's not about making money. And by the way, I don't think accounting make that much money. They do lah. They count money. They count a lot of money, but they don't think about money. But that's what was drilled in her mind, is in the career that I choose should be the one that make the most money. I'm talking about. And so, it's not about that, it's about the calling and the destiny and whatever that God has called us to be. You know, and parents, our job is to be stewards of our children and just guide them along the way and hear God on behalf of them more times and just help them along the way. Amen? So that they can fulfill their call, their destiny. You know, in the book of Esther, we read about how the whole situation came about where Esther had a choice to make. And she made the right choice, and therefore deliverance came because of her. I want to talk about consecration. Consecration. Because before Esther did what she did, she had to come to a place of what we call consecration. And consecration is not a term that we commonly use in church, it's not a very popular term either. But I'll just attempt to explain and to help us to understand why consecration is key for us to fulfill all that God wants us to do. So in Esther chapter 4, we read yesterday in verse 14, when you know Mordecai came pleading to Esther and said, Esther, you gotta help us out. If you don't, deliverance will come from another place anyway. But it says, verse 14, and who knows but that you have come to your royal position for such a time as this. So that was a challenge, the appeal that Mordecai gave to Esther. And then in verse 15, Esther responded. Esther sent reply to Mordecai. Verse 16, go gather together all the Jews who are in Susa and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my attendants will fast as you do. When this is done, I will go to the king, even though it is against the law. You can't keep it together. And if I perish, I perish. Because it was the against the law for anyone to go to the queen without being summoned. That's the simple way to convey that, right? And so it was a risk. If the king did not summon you and you would go before the king, then you could be banished or you could be killed, or, you know. And so there was a risk for her, not banished, actually you will be killed. There's a risk for Esther. And she responded in such a way that is so inspirational to all of us. It is one of the most inspirational verses for me in scripture that talks about the response of Esther. So Esther talked about calling for a fast, calling for a time of prayer, and it says, if I perish, then I perish. Esther came to a point where she said, I'm going to surrender myself to the Lord, to the point of, I know that this may cost me my life. If I perish, I perish. So layman will be, I'll just do it like, if I die, die. But it's real, the physical threat. So it was an act of consecration that she came to a place of what we call surrender. To say, God, I'm going to leave it to you right now. I'm going to obey you and leave the consequences to you. Think about that. Obedience is simply obeying because we want to obey God, because we love Him and know that His word is real. Obedience means that I will obey irregardless of the consequences. Now, it is easy for us to say that every time we obey, you know, it's easy to obey when the rewards are very clear. When mom says, you know, if you clean your room, then I'll give you 10 ringgit, sure. Right? But sometimes obedience has certain consequences. You know, you should obey God. Don't do business the way you're doing. Stop writing. Oops, if I don't write, I'm going to get the business. I'm going to lose out. Well, obey God. Leave the consequences to Him. It's a total abandonment, a surrendering, a what we call a consecration. The act of consecration is the act of surrendering. It's the act of setting apart and dedicating something or someone for God's use. So in the Old Testament, when you read of the tabernacle, the items in the tabernacle, in the temple, they were all consecrated to the Lord because the items were used for worship. So consecrating simply means that we set apart and we dedicate that which is to be used to serve God, in this case, our life. The idea of consecration is also about separation of oneself. The separation of oneself from things that are unclean, especially anything that will contaminate one's relationship with God. See, separation is, it carries the connotation of sanctification, of holiness, of purity, of just being set apart. Setting apart is always setting apart from something unto something. You have to be set apart from something, but it doesn't stop there. Then it's unto something else. So for example, if you're going to go for dinner and someone says to you that I'm coming late for dinner, can you please leave some food for me? And say, okay, sure. So you would scoop the food, right? You set apart certain food. But it's there for a reason. It was set apart so that it could be given to the person when he comes. So setting apart is always about coming out from something and dedicated to something else. So when we talk about consecration in the word, in the sense where we're talking about consecration to God, we're talking about us consecrating our lives from something, and in many cases would be from things that are wrong, sin, things that are in our lives that are not aligned to God's will, setting ourselves apart from that which is not of God, and then dedicating ourselves to that which is of God. That's consecration. Amen? It is a coming unto the Lord, is surrendering. We present and give ourselves to the Lord afresh. Consecration is a lifestyle of a believer. It is where we come to a place where we are fully devoted to an intimate and to an exclusive relationship with God. You know, God demands exclusivity. God demands exclusivity, 100% commitment. 100% dedication, 100% of our love is a too much love. Where you can demand like that one? 100% faithfulness. How can, I mean, we're human beings, so how to give God 100%? How can God be so unreasonable to demand 100%? God is not unreasonable. How do you marry Kenan? See, married couples, are you married couples? Married? Some people don't admit. Huh? 1, 2, 3, married couples. I'll answer you. All the wives say, what if your husband will come to you and says, wife, you know, I love you so much. We've been married for 25 years with you. I've been faithful to you all the time. 100% faithful to you, right? Yes, I love you. Tell what, 25 years with you. You give me one night. Just one night. Let me spend just one night with another woman. That's all I ask. Not too much to ask, right? Come on. After 25 years of faithfulness to you, I just want one night with another woman. No big deal. Women, turn it up. Because you demand 100% faithfulness from your husband. Agree? So in the same way, when God communicates to us and He talks about the commitment and the surrendering, He wants an exclusivity from us, our heart. So it's not something demanding. It is Him wanting that love relationship with us, where we consecrate our lives to Him, where we learn to what I call dethrone ourselves and enthrone Christ in our life. Why we need to consecrate, and perhaps some of us have grown cold in our walk with God. Some of us need to renew our relationship with Him. Some of us perhaps are careless in the way that we walk in sin and we are off target. Some of us have, in exchange for that which is God, has just done things which are good, and we realize it's good, but they may not be God in it. That's why I said yesterday it's possible to live a fairly successful life and completely miss God. Therefore, we need to come to a place of consecration. See, the basis of our consecration towards God is very simple. See, we consecrate to Him means we dedicate ourselves to Him, we surrender to Him. The basis of our consecration to God is because in the first place, we belong to God. Everyone say, I belong to God. You see, God, so-called, owns us. We belong to God. If I go to a pet shop and buy a dog, you know, I bring the dog home. If the dog will talk, if la. I bring the dog home and the dog says, I want to go back to the pet shop. I want to go back to the pet shop. I don't want to stay in the house. I will tell the dog, no, I paid for you. You are mine and you belong to me right now. See, it's a principle of ownership. In the scripture, in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, this is how Paul teaches it. Paul says this, 1 Corinthians 6, 19, 20. He says, don't you realize that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, who lives in you and was given to you by God? Help me read this. You do not belong to yourself. You do not belong to yourself, for God bought you with a high price. So you must honor God with your body. Wow. I don't know whether you've ever thought of your life and my life this way. We don't own ourselves. We belong to Him, and God bought us for the high price of Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen? That's what scripture uses terms to describe Jesus, like He is Lord. Lord meaning that He is master, He is ruler. You know, someone once said this, but I think it's true. If Jesus is not Lord of all, He is not Lord at all. If you're Lord, then you're judge. If you are Lord and then certain things you cannot give the shots, or you can't have a decision on certain things, then you are not Lord. If someone really acknowledges you as Lord, then he is the Lord of everything else. So scripture uses the word like He is the Lord, He is our King. Another term that scripture uses, which I'll go about in a moment, is that we are born servants of Christ. Born servants means servants that serve for life. Even the next generation of the one servant will serve the master. It is 100% exclusivity that is sold out and given unto the Lord. Romans 14:8 says it this way. It says that if we live, it's to honor the Lord. And if we die, it's to honor the Lord. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. Whether we live, we die, we belong to God on heaven and on earth. You know, some of us, you know, we only think about heaven. We say, oh, I want to be with God's presence. I want to be with God when I die. You know, I have church members, you know, very funny, they will come and they will apply for church membership, you know. And we talk to them, you know why they want to apply for church membership. The most important thing is, Pastor, when we die, you will do a funeral one, right? I say, yes, yes, you'll do your funeral. And they were very, you know, worried that no one will bury them. And so they want to be church members so that when they die, the pastor will do their funeral for them. Because they make sure they want to have a proper funeral. I don't know, maybe they're thinking that, you know, then they can go to heaven or something. So we're very caught up with wanting to be with God, wanting to live for God, with God in heaven. But this scripture tells us whether we live is to honor the Lord, whether we die is to honor the Lord, whether we live or we die, we belong to God. As much as we're concerned that we want to live for God and be with Him after here, after earth, we should be as concerned that when we're on earth, we should also be living for Him. Amen? Wanting to be with Him. We cannot have it both ways. Here, I don't care about God, but when I die, I want God. Romans says, on earth and heaven. See, although we belong to God, because it's about ownership, God owns us and our lives are His. But the way God moves is very funny, because although we are His, but He wants us to willingly surrender to Him. There's something about the sovereignty of God, which is a mystery. What do I mean by that? See, on one hand, God is sovereign. God doesn't need you and me. Yesterday I shared in Esther, right? Even if Esther would have said no, no problem, because Mordecai said deliverance will come from another place, another method, another... Somehow God will work it out. Proverbs tells us many are the plans of a man, but it's the Lord's will that will prevail. Man can plan everything, can scheme everything, but end the Lord and end the day. If God wants it to happen, God will make it happen. So God is sovereign, He's all powerful, and He's not dependent on man for anything to happen. Am I right? Agree? That's real theology, the sovereignty of God. On the other hand, it's a mystery. On the other hand, when you read scripture, it's full of situations and incidences where God says, I want you to have faith. You got no faith, means I don't move. I want you to fast and pray, then I will move. And many incidents in scripture and two at least, that Jesus didn't heal the sick because they had unbelief. Hebrews tells us, without faith, it's impossible to please God. So God says, you better have faith. You better rise up, then I will do something. On the other hand, God says, I don't need you. You got no faith, so I can do it. What's the problem? Agree? That's a mystery of how God works in our life. But I realize that God does it for us. And so my kids are helping out right now with my wife. You know, pastor's kids are God. Pastor's kids goes through, what is that word? They are called PKs, by the way, pastor's kids. Very fragile. Pastor's kids very fragile. You know, they are put in the spotlight. And they are expected to be spiritual, be well-behaved, you know, and angels, they love God and stuff like that. And so I'm very careful. You know, my vocation also not so bad. I'm very careful to protect them. To protect them and not to have them to be at a certain place where they don't need to be. Even for my wife. Not every pastor's wife is a pastor. Does it make sense? Alright? Not every pastor's wife must be head of children ministry. For whatever reason, that's the default. Pastor's wife must be head of children ministry. That's the reason. I mean, back to what I talked about yesterday, every single person with their own call, their own journey, their own destiny with God. Amen? So my kids, for example, you know, we wanted them to come for camp, of course, and like I told you, this is like three camps in a row. In fact, my boy is four camps. Because just before our camp last week, he went for his own school camp with arrows and Pam Siebert was the speaker for his camp. So it's like four camps, and so they were like, we must, and then it's school holiday. And school holiday, like to do what? Holiday lah.
You know, play with friends, and their friends are arranging outings and stuff like that, and they're like, oh, I want to go out, you know, with my friends and stuff like that. You know, what, you think my kid's so spiritual? Oh, we're going for camp. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're going for church camp. Come on. That's called, let me say normal, please.
Normal.
My kids are normal. If my kids come and tell me, oh, daddy, I'm so happy we get to go to church camp. I don't have to go out with my friends. I'm so happy. They're all watching Wonder Woman. I don't get to watch. I'm so happy. I said, hey, Pastors don't tell you some things, but this is, hello, pastors, real one, okay? You pinch, you are pain, okay? You go hungry, we don't like to fast. Whichever pastor tell you, I love to fast and pray, lying, lying. But every year in our church, we go through a 21 days or 40 days fast, at least one. We did one 21 days fasting in prayer early, we did another one in July, 40 days this time. But so my kids, so I told them, remember my wife was talking, there's not many kids here. She says, actually we don't need our kids to run the children program here. We don't need them. Without them, my wife can still run the children's ministry here. We don't need them, but we want them. We want them to be here. Because it's part of their discipling, it's part of their walk with God, it's part of their journey, it's part of, you know what I'm talking about? So at the end of the day, you know, if the kids were not here, the children ministry would still be fantastic. I'm speaking by faith. Trust my wife will do a good job, right? Because my wife is experienced now, she'll still do a good job. We don't without my kids. But because my kids are here these few days, I trust that something is happening in their heart and God is using them. Does that make sense? So, and God is using these 2-3 days to help them deepen their own walk with God. So that's where a lot of times we let me understand that although God don't need us, but He wants to use us. He wants to use us. He has His plan, His purpose in our life. So He wants us to come to a place where we will willingly surrender ourselves to Him. And Paul teaches this in Romans chapter 12, verse 1. When he says, therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. He says, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to what? Offer. Who does the offering? We. The offering comes from us. See, in the Old Testament, the animal sacrifices were being offered for forgiveness of sin. Alright, before they come to the temple, they must pull their bull on, they must bring their doves on, they must bring whatever to be sacrificed. Aren't you glad you're going to do that when you come to church? Alright? Because Jesus completed the work through the cross. Amen? He's the perfect sacrifice. So there's no need to bring the bulls and the doves and whatnot to sacrifice. The sacrifice that God looks for is our life. That's why it's called offer your bodies as a living, arrested living. Living sacrifice. Someone once said that the problem with living sacrifices is they can crawl to the altar, then they can crawl out of the altar. Crawl in and crawl out. Because living. But that's how God designed it to be. Because God doesn't want to violate our free will. And God wants a relationship out of us. And He wants us, when we begin to come to Him, to consecrate means to willingly lay down our lives and sacrifice unto Him. Because it's a love relationship. See, at conversion means when you come to accept Christ, right? See, at conversion, God gives to me the finished work of Jesus Christ. He gives to me. And I receive it. Does that make sense? That's what happened at conversion. See, at conversion, God gives to me. But in consecration, I give to God. Does that make sense? At conversion, God gives to me. In consecration, I give to God. And many of us, when we begin to live our lives, we need to learn to live beyond conversion and come into consecration. Some of us are just in that conversion a state where we are happy, and we met people like that. That's why the church, as a church, one of our roles is to disciple people, and people are just being happy, being safe, and nothing else. All I want is that I say the sinner's prayer, and I'm there, and I'm safe, and I don't doubt that they're safe. But God, beyond the conversion, then comes that consecration of the giving of our lives to God, and says, God, use my life. I willingly offer myself to you. Because God is after our heart. So we willingly say, God, I give you. So we willingly, what I call, we dethrone ourselves so that Christ can be enthroned in our lives. See, there are some things that no one else can do for us. Only we can do for ourselves. Because the pastor can preach, the pastor can encourage, but we have to make the decision ourselves to offer ourselves unto the Lord in consecration. And the motivation for us to want to consecrate to God is very simple. It's love. Because I love God, I consecrate myself. Similarly, when I gave the husband and wife illustration, why would a husband want to stay 100% faithful? Because of love, isn't it? Because I love my wife too much to hurt her. I love my wife too much that I commit 100% to my wife in terms of my faithfulness towards her. So consecration is because of love. That's the motivation of consecration. In fact, the love of God compels us to consecrate. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 14 and 15, it says, for Christ's love compels us, because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died to ourselves, old self. Verse 15, it says, and he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves. Okay, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. For the love, for Christ's love compels us, because God loves us so much, in response, we no longer live for ourselves, but for Him. See, when we are loved by someone naturally, if you really understand love and really receive love from someone, the only natural response is to love back. Is to love back. And if we understand how much and catch the revelation of how much God has loved us, forgiven us, restored us, healed us, redeemed us, called us, has showered His amazing grace and love in our lives, then the only appropriate response is to love Him back. That's consecration. It's choosing to live a life for Christ. Choosing to live for Him. In the Old Testament, the book of Exodus, it tells us about the relationship between the servant and the master. And it says that if there's a servant, and if the servant has served the master for 6 years, and on the seventh year, which we call the year of freedom, all right, they can actually go free on the seventh year. If he has a wife, all right, before he came into the master's house, then the wife and the servant can go free. But if the wife was given by the master, then the guy can go free, but the wife and the kids belong to the master. So every 6 years or the seventh year is like you can go free, you know, and in God's economy, we call this Jubilee. It's God's way of resetting. I love God's, how God thinks, resetting. Yes. There's nothing that is impossible. Whenever we face failures, disappointments, setbacks in life, you know, how many of us wish that we could just press the reset button? You wish you can?
Yes.
You can. Because God's grace is more than enough and empowers us, and He can just help to reset our lives. There is nothing too difficult for Him, nothing that is beyond redemption. Amen? We can reset. There is forgiveness, there is healing, there is restoration, there could be consequences. But His strength and His grace will be sufficient for us to go through. His grace is sufficient. That's what Paul says, my grace is sufficient. Sufficient means enough. Grace is the supernatural empowerment of God given to us to do that which we are called to do. That's grace. When we have grace, we are not at a disadvantage. Sometimes when we go through a life, it's, oh, I'm a disadvantage, no, I don't have an education, I'm not usually graduate, I failed my business, or I failed my marriage, so I'm in this position, you know, I came from a broken home, so I'm in this position, I'm at a disadvantage position. No, you're not at a disadvantage position if you know the grace of God in your life. You know, we play golf, you know, I play golf whenever I can, not very regularly, you know, but I've not played for the last 5 months actually. You know, and when Pastor Ron is in KL, we play quite regularly. And, well, by the way, I heard he never played for so long to me yesterday. For your sake, you know, he sacrificed. He didn't play also for 4 or 5 months, I think. 5 months, both of them played for 5 months. And in golf, how many play golf? Anyone else play golf?
Yeah.
Okay, so, in golf, you have this concept called a handicap. Handicap means, you know, if your low handicap is 1 to 24. Okay, to make it simple means if I am you know, he's definitely a much better player. So meaning if we play, if I'm a handicap 24, if he's a handicap 22, means he's giving me 2 free strokes. That means actually when we start the game, although he's a better golfer than me, because he's handicap 22, I'm 24, he already gave me chance 2 strokes. Understand? So if we start the game, we are level. Does that make sense? Level. So grace is something like that. No matter what disappointment you have, what setback you have, you say, oh, I'm like that, I'm not going to succeed, I'm going to... No. God's grace elevates you to a place that you will never be disadvantaged. It empowers you always to do that which you need to do. So in Exodus, when we have this this concept of the slaves being able to go free at the 7th year, but the slave also have a choice. Alright, and this is found in Exodus 21. The slave has a choice. The slave can say this, but if the slave declares, that means the slave, you tell the slave, you can actually go free now, the 7th year. But verse 5 says, but if the servant declares, help me read, I love my master. Wow. What a term to use. But if the servant declares, I love my master and my wife and my children and do not want to go free. What's wrong with this fellow? Been slave for the last 6 years, now he's approaching to go. And he said, I do not want to go free. Then his master will take him to the door of the doorpost. And pierce his ear with an awl. Now it's a sharp object, pierce the ear. Then he will be his servant for life. So there's an option. On the 7th year, when the servant is supposed to go free, the servant can voluntarily say, I choose not to go free. I love my master. I do not want to go free. And then there's a ceremony. They say, okay, nobody forced you to be here, so you better call the elders. And then they will do this little ceremony where they'll go to a door or a doorpost. Then they will use this sharp object to pierce a hole into the servant's ear as a marking. And therefore, when the servant goes around, whenever you see a servant, there's a marking on their ear, then you know already, oh, this is the servant right now, who is serving, not out of obligation, but out of love. Who has willingly surrendered his or her freedom to serve the master. Isn't that amazing? And that's what consecration is. It is the willingness of us coming unto God and says, God, I serve you not because I have to, but because I want to. See, piercing is a mark of ownership. You know, when some of you watch movies and you know, when they have slaves, they will brand the slaves. They will use an iron and they will brand the slaves. They are being marked, branded. Because whoever sees that marking knows that, oh, this slave belongs to this person, this slave belongs to that person. So that piercing of the ear is a sort of like a marking. They will mark for ownership to tell clearly who they belong to. permanent marking so that it can be displayed outwardly for everyone to see that without doubt, this person belongs to this master. In the same way, when we begin to talk about consecration and coming unto him, there need to be an inward piercing of the heart that will always result in a public display of our commitment towards the Lord. You know, some Christians live their life, and if you are walking or talking with them, you have no idea that they are Christians because they are saved. You know, I was told, which is true, that I just spent some time with Pastor Mark Barnard, and he's going to speak to you, I think, and he was telling me the statistics, and I read this before, and it's true. We're talking about church divorce rates in the US. He says the divorce rate in US is about 52%. 52%. So one in every two marriages, couples are, you know, come from that background. And that statistics, the divorce statistics, is no different in the church. That means when you go outside the church, one in two non-Christians are divorced. When you come into the church, one in two Christians are also divorced. You know, I think that is sad, right? That is sad. Because if there is a consecration unto the Lord, a marking, our public life will be clearly seen and clearly distinguished. And people can clearly see that we are different. Amen?
Amen.
Clearly see that we are different. You know, when I was working with Unilever, you know, my boss's secretary, they were quite a number of us in that department, but me and my friend, his name is Kevin, he attends Glad Tidings GDPJ, he was my subordinate actually, and this secretary is a Buddhist, you know, and she had a son, a young kid, you know, and one day we were just talking to her, and then she came to just both of us, and he said, hey, my son grew up, I want my son to be like, oh, you are, just talking, then we said, why? And we said, oh, you are. I basically the goody two shoes lah. You know the goody two shoes? We don't drink, we don't smoke, we don't party, you know? Yeah. I said, hey, that's a nice compliment. That's a really nice compliment. And thank God, because when people see us, they must see the physical marking that's in our ears. Now, of course, not physical, not talking about. They must see through our lifestyle. This is one man and one woman who has clearly separated his or her life. That when we watch his or light, is clearly distinguished between darkness and light. You can clearly see that marking. And it's interesting that the whole thing actually says that he shall take him to a door or a doorpost and pierce his ear with an awl. And why a door and a doorpost? It's a ceremony. And so they go to this door. Because the door represents an opening. An entrance into somewhere new. Am I right? So the door is symbolic of, look, the new life is before you. It is meant for you to be now entering into a new environment, transferring from one environment right now to another environment, something new. You're entering into a new divine life right now, something totally different, because now you're chosen right now to serve your master. Willingly and out of love into a new life. And what I encourage is move from conversion into a place of consecration. Okay. Not just one time, but a lifestyle of consecration. And piercing the ears, because the ears talks about what? The ears talks about hearing, isn't it? The ears talk about obedience. Obedient to the voice of the master. You must know that although he is a free person right now, because he's not serving out of obligation, but he's still 100% the master servant, still under the master's control. Does that make sense? He's not gone to gain his freedom, you know. In fact, he rejected his freedom. You know, we live in a society right now, in a times where people want freedom. Everything, financial freedom, want this freedom, that freedom. Young people don't want to work 9-to-5 job, they want freedom, want to start their own business, they want freedom. So they want freedom, 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 thinking that freedom is good. But freedom that is not used properly is bad. You know, if I give my children all the freedom they have, they will mess up their life. If they come back and want to watch as much TV as they want to, and play as much computer games as they want to, and I give them all the freedom, that freedom will kill them, will ruin them. And we live in a very chauvinistic society where people say, I want freedom, I want freedom. Why must be committed to one church? Why must be bogged down by ministry, then turn up every Sunday and then do this? I want freedom. I don't want commitment. But that's simply a reflection of a heart that is not consecrated to God. Because freedom, in the sense I'm talking about, doesn't free us, it actually puts us in bondage. Because there's no commitment, there's no dedication, there is no giving of our lives, surrendering to the plan, the purpose, and the destiny of God. So it's about obeying the voice of the Master. Don't ask for victory if you have not walked in obedience. Think about that. Don't ask for victory in life if you have not walked in obedience. It is like someone, some student coming to God and says, God, my exam coming, please, all A's, all A's, all A's are God, please. And he never studied. Right? If God were to grant him his request and give him all A's, although he would never study, which God will never do. That's what many people expect God to do. God is just being a bad parent, right? Oh, never study also reward him. God is just a bad parent, he's not a bad parent. Right? So don't ask for victory if you're not walking in obedience. Because obedience always precedes victory in life. There are many principles in scripture which is conditional. If you will do this, God will do that. If you do this, God will do that. Amen? And one of the things that we know for sure when we begin to obey God, in Isaiah it says, if you're willing and obedient, you will eat of the good of the land. If you're willing and obedient, consecrated your life to God, serving Him, God will come and bless, consecrating everything. In Esther's case, even her own life. But for us, us learn to consecrate everything, our work, our body, our finances. You know, I had a lady who came to me, we're talking about money right now, we were teaching on tithing and giving, big promise, you know, giving. And then this lady came to me and says, Pastor Eric, you know, I don't tithe. Because you know, I'm very tight and all that, so I don't tithe. And he says, no, I'm sure God understands. So I told her, I said, yeah, God understands, but He's not happy. Of course God understands, but it's not happy. It means there's no excuses that we can give unto the Lord. But it is another thing altogether. I mean, in our church experience, in my personal experience, but I was just encouraging her to say that, you know, it's not about that, it's about honoring the Lord first. When God becomes first, everything falls in place. Seek ye what? First, the kingdom of God and His righteousness. All these things will be added unto you. Back to tithing. Tithing is simply giving God the first. It's giving God the first. It's acknowledging that He is Lord of all. And we see how God will open up everything else. Because we ask very often for breakthrough, for God to provide for His provision, for His blessing in our life, without understanding the need to consecrate. Remember the story of Abraham and how Abraham was promised a son. And after how many years old, then he and Sarah had a son, and Isaac? 100, right? And Isaac came. Right? When Isaac was just a teenager, God asked him to sacrifice Isaac, his only son. In fact, what's wrong? First, he promised me the son. Then never get so long. Then the son finally came. And then now one asked me to sacrifice still my son. And so in Genesis, we read the story of how Isaac brought him all the way to the mountain and placed his son on the altar. And when he was about to, the scripture, very dramatic, he was about to actually kill the son, the angel of the Lord stopped him. And the angel of the Lord, he says, stop. He says, now I know that you love and you obey the Lord. And the angel was saying that it was a test that you obey. Then he began to, then he stopped. Then what happened next was a ram, remember? A ram that was there, that was caught in the thick bushes, the ram. And then that ram was used in replacement as the sacrifice. First he wanted to stab, but he came to the place of consecration. Consecration means I surrender, I give all, not my will, but your will be done. I obey you, I leave the consequences to you. So he's ready, consecrated, he's about to stab. The angel stopped him. He passed the test. He looked around, the ram. Provision always comes after surrender. Always comes after surrender. So consecration is the key. Don't seek the healing, seek the healer. Don't seek the blessing, seek the blessing. It's always about us coming before Him, bearing our hearts before Him, dethroning ourselves and dethroning Christ in our life. Amen. And this morning, I want to encourage us as we close. And we can ask the musicians to come and help me as we close. Let's learn to give our hearts and our lives unto God. Let's come to a place of consecration before Him this morning and say, God, I want your will to be done in my life. Lord, I want you to move in my heart. Would you just stand to your feet as we begin to close, just where you are. If you could sing the song, maybe, God, I give you my life, please, I say, would you just raise your hand where you are this morning to begin to pray. You want to come to a place of surrender this morning. You see, you and I will never fulfill our call and destiny without consecration. You see, some people don't understand how God works. We think, if God wants it done, it will be done, but I'm not going to do anything. No, there is a contending. The church will never reach its full destiny if you don't contend for it. And faith and fight the battle, and every day you're powering, every day you're praying, every day you're engaging in warfare, every day you are. We don't just close our eyes and just, if God wants it done, it will be done. Our responsibility is to consecrate. It is not as simple as just saying, oh God, if God wants it to be done, then you open the door for me. Well, if you're not obedient, the door will not be open in the first place. Does that make sense? So the part of us is then to, our role is then to say, God, I offer myself as a living sacrifice in consecration unto you. Use my life for your glory. I am submitted to your Lordship. I choose to willingly surrender my freedom, and I choose not to go free like a servant, but still come under the authority in my life. Just lift your hands as you worship. This is my desire to know. Thank you. nobody can do for me. There are some things only you can do it for yourself. And God certainly will not cause you to do it, because He desires you to willingly say, because I love my Master, therefore I don't want to go free. I choose to concentrate, to surrender to Him. There are some things no one else can do for you. You have to come to a place called surrender, and you will embrace surrender, because there comes the freedom. And when the surrendering happens, then the provision comes next. You will see everything changes, because now your perspective in life is different, because you understand that you no longer belong to yourself. You and I belong to the Most High God. Amen. And if He's really Lord of all, and He's really King of Kings, you don't think He'll take care of us? Everything changes. Everything changes. We live our lives full of faith and confidence, and victory and success, hitting the bullseye. But it takes us to consecrate. Amen. So as we sing this song one more time, we're going to open up the altars for you to make a decision. You say, I want to consecrate, I want to surrender my life to the Lord. You come, and if you can, just kneel down where you are, just in front of here. Would you do that right now as we need to sing? Hallelujah, Jesus. Amen. This is my desire. This is my desire. Would you come right now? It's your place of consecration. Your place of consecration.